Hi everyone, this is GKCS. In today's video, we'll go through Google Borg, which is a paper from 2015. But Google Borg has been there for 2 decades at Google, since 2005. And the reason why it's lasted so long is because it's an absolute core system of Google. It provides compute and memory for processes. 98% of all the servers at Google are running because of Borg. So Borg manages the entire lifecycle of a process. From start to finish, if you're an application developer, all you have to worry about is your code. And once you're ready, you just deploy. Borg goes and finds the different data centers to deploy this to. It finds the right number of resources that have to be allocated. It makes sure that in case it crashes, it's restarted. And in case it's just failing a lot, then it has to be migrated. Everything end to end is managed by Borg. It's so good and so popular that open source project, you might have heard of this, Kubernetes, is developed by the engineers at Google who built Borg. And this is extremely similar to Borg. I would say 90% of the internal architecture is understandable if you go through this paper. So by the end of this video, I hope that, you know, Kubernetes is also easy to understand. And as with Kubernetes, Borg has similar requirements. It does load balancing, make sure that services are deployed across the hardware that you have, judiciously utilize the money that you have spent. The other thing it does is process lifecycle management. Part of this is service discovery, meaning you have to identify where a process exists. Borg has a list of this. If you deploy your application, let's say Google Maps, and you deploy this in 2 clusters and you have 50 total servers which are running this, Borg is going to note down where they are running. In case one of them crashes, then it's going to restart it. But also, if you're the application developer and want to know where exactly they're running, you can see an entire list. So Borg has something called Borg Naming Server, DNS, BNS. They have everything. It also manages auto-scaling. At this day and age, 2025, this seems simple. But in 2005, this was a big deal. And Google used to manage Google Scale, auto-scaling at that time. And the final thing is capacity planning. This to me seems like a more machine or hardware problem, but Borg can help you do that by giving you the proper metrics and observability. If you're a DevOps engineer, you can look at the amount of services which an application needs, and based on that, you can go and buy a fleet of servers if you need to. You can basically make good business decisions based on this. So these are the features of Borg. What's the scale like? Pretty big. 4 billion containers are deployed every week at Google. 4 billion containers. These are like 4 billion processes. As you can expect, it is highly configurable because you have all the engineers at Google, pretty much everybody at Google using Borg, they have their own requirements. If you give them an extensible configurable system, then they're going to use it. Otherwise, they'll find their own solutions. So you don't want that to happen. You want the system to be easily usable, but at the same time, extensible. And finally, it is highly available. The way to think of this is everything runs on Borg. So GFS runs on Borg. Spanner, you're right, it runs on Borg. Everything, including Bigtable, which basically manages Google search, runs on this application. If Borg fails, then Google is down. So that can't happen. That has to happen extremely rarely. And you'll see the kind of things that Borg does to make sure that this doesn't happen. Okay, before we start with the internals of Borg, I'll just tell you the differences between Borg and Kubernetes. Maybe you can skip this part if you're not interested in Kubernetes, but because this is a very popular project, I'll just mention the high-level differences. The first thing is Kubernetes is open source. Borg isn't. Borg is set to be deployed in very large cells or clusters. Kubernetes can be deployed at almost any scale. The main benefit of Kubernetes is not just that it's open source, it's also easier to learn. It has better documentation, and it has better APIs. The APIs are designed with generic terms. Borg has very Google-specific or Borg terms. The other thing is that Kubernetes has decentralized orchestration. So Borg has a central server, Borg master, which tells you will do this task, you will do this task. But Kubernetes has a set of microservices which manage different parts of the cluster. And so it is, you can say, better, more modern. But Borg also works, so it's just a more of a design choice. One interesting point that I noticed about Kubernetes is you can actually tag the pods that you have in Kubernetes. Those are called Borglets here, pods and Borglets. They're the same concept, but In Kubernetes, you can say that these pods are part of Google Maps, but here you can't. Okay, you have to go and actually query for with a particular regex. Also, you can say that this is production, or you can say that this is in India. All of those tags can be given in Kubernetes, but Borg doesn't have such a rich language. Querying and debugging and observability is slightly improved here. For all I know, it's 2025. Borg has probably taken all of these open source ideas and already moved it here. They are not going to mention that in the paper. But yes, that is a small difference. Okay, let's get into the internals of Borg. Every Borg job has a state, which is defined by the priority of the task. So this might be production level, or batch level, or just free. Free is basically things which don't really matter as much as a MapReduce job in prod, or real-time application in prod. And even before this, there's actually monitoring. So monitoring is most important, because if things fail, then
these jobs have to exist.
So that's at the highest priority level. What happens is, if you have a job which is running, let's say at priority batch, and you have an incoming job of production, then this job is going to be preempted. It's going to be killed, and this machine is actually going to pick up this new job. Okay, this is a simple algorithm. Low priority jobs are kicked out. Sometimes this can become really bad. Let's say you have a monitoring job coming, and you have a production job over here, then this job is going to get killed and move to some other place which is batch, and then this job is going to get killed and move to some other place which was running free, resulting in a lot of jobs being killed. And so to avoid this, production jobs cannot be preempted. Okay, you can only kick out existing batch or free jobs. This is just a way to avoid the cascade. There's other things also that a Borg job can contain. One of them is rules or constraints. So you may specify the type of operating system that you need, and basically generic rules. You can talk about the IP addresses and so on. Now, this can look like a linear programming problem, right? That you want the region to be India, but you want 10 large servers and so on. And then Borg has to figure out how to allocate these things in the most efficient way possible. Yes, it can be. So the engineers can provide constraints, but most engineers don't. They don't really need these kind of constraints. Most use cases are that, you know, just run this job somewhere and things are fine. But the constraints are a possibility. Now, when we say running a job, where is this? What is this exactly? Is it a virtual machine? Well, it can be, but most Borg jobs are not running on a VM. This VM is too slow. Like a Windows VM is a bit slow. So instead, what you can do is use a Linux container. The security is managed by chroot jail. If you know about these things, then congratulations, you know quite a bit about Linux. And resources are managed by cgroup. These are Linux specific terms. This is basically a way to make sure that some resources are allocated to a particular container. And this is to make sure that nobody else gets access to this. In fact, you might have done chmod in your life sometime when changing file permissions. Think of it like that. And here, cgroup, you can think of how much network, how much file storage do I give this container. So in this way, you make sure that an engineer who's an application engineer can run their application knowing that
I need at least
this much file storage, just for logs, let's say. Once they have defined that here, you can execute this on a VM or a Linux container. If you have to restart a process, send a sig term signal here, which is basically kill minus 15, means please die. And if you don't die, then there are other ways, which is sig kill. That's a kill minus 9. Okay, again, things that you might have used in Linux. It forces the container to shut down, and then it can be restarted. Borg has the concept of a cell, which is about 10,000 machines. At Google scale, this 10,000 machines sounds like a small cell, but this is a pretty big number. So a single cell has one Borg master. Okay, it's a single point of failure, but we'll see why availability is not affected much, even if it goes down. The basic idea is, if a Borg master goes down, then the Borglets continue functioning. And a Borg master sets up the configuration of the Borglets, which are basically like pods in Kubernetes. It tries to assign these tasks which come to it. Okay, these are commands which are sent that please execute this application on 5,000 machines. Once a cell is chosen, Borg master then tries to spread this application for high fault tolerance. So you'll have different power domains, you'll have different regions. And this is actually a bin packing problem. The basic idea is if you have an application running here, app one, and you have another application running here, app two, and a third application is coming in, one of these two, then which one do you choose? So do you choose the one which has a perfect fit with app three? So then what happens is this is running at 100% capacity, best fit, maximum usage, or do you try to find any one which can take care of app three? So let's say there's 60% compute remaining here, and here you only had 30% remaining. App 3 required 30%, you gave 30%, it's the best fit, but you could have put it here as well, it didn't matter. So this would have been faster, lower assignment, but it would be a bad fit. So at scale, maybe the compute power would be wasted. If the next process has 40% compute power required, and you put 30% in here, then you have only 30% remaining, and with both of these with 30, this new app can't fit anywhere. This looks like a really bad idea, but the idea with Borg is they want to quickly assign tasks to the Borglets. And the second thing is best fit has a risk in case this app takes more than 30%. It claims that I can do with 30%, but if it takes 35%, as is common with MapReduce jobs, you kind of underplay the requirements you need, then this app is going to crash. So resilience is a problem here. Borg, what it tries to do is it takes a hybrid of these two approaches and it tries to fit the application in a place which has some space remaining. So let's say 40% or 50%, but it also tries to fit them snugly. So that's the approach, a hybrid fit algorithm. Now, once an application is assigned to a Borglet, once it is running here, there is a mapping added in a service called BNS. It stands for Borg Naming Service. Okay, very similar to a domain name server. This keeps a server to IP mapping. So in this case, you're going to have something like, let's say this is the 30th server of app one. So that's going to be 30.app1. The user who has executed this command on Borg master, the cell ID .borg.google.com. I don't know why they have this part. I think it just sounds cool or something. But in this way, you can have some sort of a regex which says borg.google.com is at the end for this cell ID. So you're doing an inverse or the reverse regex. This cell ID, this user who has started the task for this application, get me all the servers. And then Chubby can store these in a file with their states. So this application is currently pending, meaning it has to be picked up. It has to be assigned to some Borglet. This one is running and this one is stopped. Okay, so different states, and also the health of the Borglet can be noted down over here. All the metadata around execution is stored in Chubby. Chubby, in case you don't know, is a Paxos based persistent store. This is used by Google. It's a key value store. The problem with Chubby now is that they have Google Spanner, which is a highly consistent, highly available system. Chubby is a distributed lock service, so it is highly consistent if you have all of your writes on Chubby, but I'm not sure if Borgmaster has actually moved to Spanner now. Another interesting point is these Borglets, when they're running the applications, store the logs of these files in a local file. I was expecting that these will go to Google file system, but no, these are just local files and they're rotated. So every day or every hour, the frequency is not mentioned, but the files are actually deleted. So after the Borglet has finished processing this app or moved it from one place to another, these logs will be deleted. So within 1 or 2 days after the movement, the logs are purged. It's interesting to note that metrics from this application are also emitted. Earlier, there used to be something called Borgmon. Now there is something called Monarch. You can check out the video explaining this time series data store. The basic idea here is it helps in observability of the system. And if you're looking for business decisions, then these app metrics are again sent to Dremel. So here you can fire SQL queries to see how much capacity do you need, or what kind of applications are taking up most of the compute power. Based on this, we can make business decisions. The funny thing is, if a machine is running out of some sort of resource, let's say you're running out of memory, then you can't avoid it. Like, you can't get more memory in the same machine. So Borg starts killing processes. And the first ones it kills are the ones with low priority. So batch jobs or free jobs, those are taken care of. in case it's a temporary issue, like CPU usage is 100% or IO is completely choked out, in that case, Borg actually waits for a while. But again, if things don't improve, then processes start to die, starting with lowest to higher priority. Now, you might be wondering what happens if Borg master dies. Yes, Borglets continue functioning, but one issue is if it dies, then no new task can come in. So it's important not to let it die. And you have basically replicas of Borg master. So these are in-memory replicas, and there are five of these. They have lead election using Paxos. What happens is, since they are in sync, in case one Borg master dies, then another is elected, and then it takes care of the provisioning here with the Borglets. This is mostly taken care of again by Chubby, which stores all the state of the Borg master. Finally, there are some optimizations that Borg has for scaling up. One of them is caching, very heavy use of caching. The idea is a Borglet has some parameters. It's in a region, it is of a particular size, the server has a particular size, and maybe it has a power outlet, it's connected to this. So all of these things are common. You don't have to recompute it again and again. Unless you're changing the configuration or the physical server, you don't have to change the score or the definition of this Borglet. So all of this config information is cached in Borg master. So when it's making a decision, where should I send this application to? It has all of this config cached. It has the scores of each Borglet cached. And so it can quickly make a decision as to where to send this application to. Similarly, applications are not very different. You know, you have Google Maps, which is a kind of an application. You'll have email, which is a kind of an application. Many of these are going to be similar. So instead of having each application specific requirements, you have a class of applications. So one might be IO intensive, another might be memory intensive, another might be CPU intensive. So now, based on the class of the app you're running, you can find the appropriate Borglet. This again is something which you can constrain in the number of variations and also cache. And lastly, when an application is going to be assigned, Borg tries to find Borglets which already have the libraries required for that application. This is similar to Bazel, which caches the libraries. So instead of you caching the libraries in every Borglet, of course, you find the best fit based on already installed libraries. And this reduces the start time from 25 seconds to just 5 seconds. So deploying an application across thousands of servers becomes a very fast process. So that's it for Google Borg. It's a very interesting and simple system. Most of Google runs on it. 98% of Google runs on it. What I find interesting about it is it's got this concept of cells. It's got this concept of Borg master and Borglet. That's almost all of the containerization logic that you have. Everything else is external. And this was made in 2005. So concepts like autoscaling and cross-region fault tolerance were not very common back then. But Google solved this problem. Their principal engineers went ahead and actually made this system, which has lasted for 2 decades now. So thank you for watching this video. If you have any doubts or suggestions, do let me know in the comments. If you like the video, then do hit the like button. And if you want notifications for further videos like this, hit the subscribe button. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.